والسلام على سيدنا ومولانا محمد خاتم الأنبياء وإمام المرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد: ألا إن أولياء الله لا خوف عليهم ولا هم يحزنون. صدق الله العظيم. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي: يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا ومولانا محمد وبارك وسلم وسلم عليه. All praise to Allah, the creator of the universe, infinite salutations and the choicest blessing be upon our liege lord, our master, our salvation, Sayyiduna Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, upon his holy household and his noble companions. I begin with the translation of the Quran, and especially the ayah that I mentioned is indeed the awliya of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They are close servants of Allah who have no khawf upon them. They have no fear upon them. Walahum yahzun. And they have no fear. They are not grieved by anything. Why? Because their dedication and their commitment to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sacrificing time, effort, and all of their, breaths in for the sake of the deen of Allah. This talk I prepared and I used mainly a book by a great Farsi scholar, Sheikh Muhammad Mahdi al-Farsi, who was born in 1033 and passed away in 1109. He was born 200 years after Imam Muhammad ibn Sulaiman al-Jazuli, and who we're going to be talking about today. He wrote this book called Mumti' al-Asma, the pleasure of hearing, fi zikr al-Jazuli wal-Atba', in the remembrance of the memory of Imam Jazuli and his followers. It's one of the most, I'd say, mu'tabar, considered and very authentic biography or hagiography of the life of Imam Muhammad ibn Sulaiman al-Jazuli, al-Simlali al-Sharif al-Hasani. So this is what I've used it on, and it's nice to know that the Farsi scholars have a great link with the Shadiliya, because Muhammad Mahdi al-Farsi was the grandson of Sheikh Yusuf al-Farsi, who is the student of Sheikh Abdul Rahman al-Majzub. Right? You had a talk about him. And Imam Sheikh Abdul Rahman al-Majzub was a student of Imam Ali al-Sanhaji, and thereafter Sheikh Ibrahim al-Afham, Sheikh Ahmed Zarruq, thereafter Sheikh Ahmed ibn Uqba al-Hadrami, Sheikh Ali al-Wafa, Sheikh Muhammad al-Wafa, Sheikh Dawood al-Bakhili. So you see the link is very close to between Imam Jazuli, Imam Abu al-Hasan al-Shadili, very close. The author of this book is the grandson of Imam Sheikh Yusuf al-Farsi, who is the student of Sheikh Abdul Rahman al-Majzub. And during the life of Imam Jazuli, he met Sheikh Ahmed Zarruq in Fez. In fact, he took tariqah for him, and he took knowledge from him, but his tariqah, or his lineage of a spiritual way, goes through another Sheikh, Sheikh Abdullah al-Muhammad al-Amghar, al-Saghir. He took money from him. So we'll start with his birth. This is about his life. So his full name is Abu Abdullah Muhammad ibn Sulaiman al-Jazuli al-Simlali al-Sharif al-Hasani. He is from the lineage of Mawla Idris, very similar to Sayyidina Sheikh Muhammad Abu al-Huda al-Ya'qubi. He was born in a place called Sus, in an area called Jazula, in the Berber tribe. He was from a Berber background, Simlala. It's called the southern Moroccan area, Jazula. He was born there in 807, although saying that many of the scholars of his biography have mentioned that his birth year was very unknown, it's very vague, very ambiguous. So the closest estimation is 807 after Hijri. When he was born, he was, you know, there's certain awliya that come through life where they have a certain background before, and then there's a moment where they change. Like Fudayl ibn Iyad, Shaykh Fudayl ibn Iyad, there's a moment when he heard the Quran and he changed. There's a moment for Bishr al-Hafi where he found, he did a form of respect for a piece of a paper which had the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on it. And then this changed his life. Imam Jazuli wasn't like that. He was nurtured and surrounded by awliya and knowledge. He was a person of great knowledge, a person of, a student of knowledge in beginning years. So firstly, he was born in southern Morocco. Due to the political environment and the political changes in the area for the Spanish and the Portuguese, who took away the Spain, the conquest of Spain from the Muslims, there was a lot of political unrest. So he moved to Fez to seek knowledge. He actually moved to a place called in the heart of Fez, in the old city, Madrasat al-Safarin. Originally it's called Halafawin, but now it's called Safarin. His actually room, his dorm, where he stayed in, is still present now, where people can visit and make dua there and make barakah from there. So he studied in Fez. His initial studies were in Fez. It is said in the biography that he actually gathered the books of Qirawin, the Jamia, the university by Sheikh Fatima al-Fihriya. She established a university. He actually contributed towards the library and the teaching of this place, studying the Maliki Madhab, mastering many sciences in fiqh and aqidah, being al ulama al rasikhun, really mutamassik, you know, really in depth scholars who know a lot, who are very vast in their knowledge in Maliki Madhab, in aqidah. And later, inshallah, when we study or understand his books that he wrote, it reflects about how much of a scholar he was and how much of an ashik he is as well. Wow. You know, we have this concept that, you know, obviously Dalail Khayrat is one of the beautiful books he wrote. It reflects upon his ishq, it reflects upon his love, his complete devotion to his connection of Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam. But also, he had a great influence of aqidah in his area, of fiqh in his area. He's a very, waqifan hudud Allah. He was a person who would stand at the boundaries of Allah, not transgressing them. He was mutamassik bil kitab al sunnah. He was one of those scholars, not a just someone who wrote salawats and he became famous. No, he was a great scholar. Imam Jazuli went to Fez and he studied in the Safarin madrasa. There's a very interesting incident that happened. Is when he was studying, he, amongst the students who would socialize, go out, come in, he would go and study and come back to his room and lock his room and remain in his room. The other students were worried about him. He was young at that time. They accused him of things and kimia, of alchemy and other things, hoarding money, not using money, the other kind of accusations they had against him. But he would be very antisocial, if you would say, but he would be very secluded. And when people seclude themselves, they are trying to find something within themselves. Individuals, people need to understand, every one of us have a secret within us. And the way to open and kind of find the secret is with seclusion under the guidance of a sheikh. So Imam Muhammad al-Jazuli, he was secluded in his room. And then his father was called from his hometown and said, your son is being very... unusual, he's being very weird, maybe you need to come and see him. So his father came and visited him, and he demanded that he open the door, because he wasn't opening the door to anyone. So he demanded that they open the door. And when they opened the door and Imam Jazuli was sat there, they walked in into a room completely covered, every inch of the wall written al-maut, 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 al-maut. This is the level of spirituality of Imam Jazuli. He was totally submerged in the dhikr of Allah, secluded to find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one of the biggest reminders of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the akhirah is what? Maut. People forget about maut. People are very drunk about the lazza, the pleasures of this dunya, where they forget about maut. Hey, one of the realities of our life, just as reality of birth, the reality of death. When we make dua, I mentioned this once in another speech, that when we make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we say, oh Allah, give us shifa al-kamila, oh Allah, give us good rizq, rizq wasi'a, al-ilm nafi'a. But one of the things we forget is, and give us khitam al-misk, you know, one of the beautiful endings, khayr al-khitam, give us a beautiful ending in this life. Because, you know, we don't know how we will pass away in this life. One of the things is a very scary moment for a believer is the time where his soul is leaving. May Allah make it easier for us, inshallah, give us all the khitam al-misk, inshallah. So his father saw this and understood what his level of spirituality was straight away. So he supported him further and continued his studies until he graduated. Study amongst the greatest sheikhs of Fez, amongst them Sheikh Ahmed Zarruq, and a few other sheikhs of his era. Thereafter, his spirituality was guided by a sheikh called Abu Abdullah al-Saghir. Abu Abdullah al-Saghir from Afghar, this great place. He took tariqah from this sheikh, who connected him to the Shadli way. So his lineage isn't via Sheikh Ahmed Zarruq. If it was, then it would be via the tariqah that I mentioned earlier. He was actually from another Shadli sheikh who gave him ijazah. As soon as he entered, at this time, he was a teacher. He was a person continuously giving dars every week. He was a murshid. He was a person guiding people. Once he met his sheikh, he left all of that. And he went into khalwa for 14 years. For 14 years, Imam Muhammad al-Jazuli went in khalwa. His litany every day was 1,000 basmalas. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Now you think it's a very easy, short, and very unusual litany as opposed to Ya Allah, La ilaha illallah, because you understand everything starts with Bismillah. Our life, our eating, our sitting, our sleeping, our everything begins with Bismillah. So once you master and I'd say become annihilated into Bismillah, because there's many understandings of Bismillah. There's in Mufti Majid can Mufti Majid Sahib can correct me. There's over 1,000 tarqibs of Bismillah, where they can begin. You know, the basic one is you put a fi'l mahzuf, and then you jar majrur. Those people know Arabic, and you bring it back. But sometimes they change the beginning mahzuf, the hidden word ashra'u or abda'u. They'll begin it with another one, atabarraku bi Bismillah. You know, I begin with the barakah of the name of Allah Subhanahu Wa Taala. So there's openings in these kind of things, saying these short litanies. Also, there's many other litanies that he recited during these 14 years. After the passing of his demise of the sheikh, he left the khalwa and he began to give irshad, give guidance to the people of his era, of his area in Afghar. Many people gave made tawbah by his hands. Why? Because the way they saw the light that emanated from his face was powerful. This is real. This, you know, people hear stories like this. I don't know how I can, us living in UK, you know, almost 800 years later, how can I explain to you that when people see a face, right, and they became instantly changed, it's literally you see the nur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see the light of obedience on the faces of these believers. That when you sit, when you're sitting in front of a sheikh, be it Sheikh Muhammad al-Yaqubi, be it any sheikh you have come across, at the end of that gathering, you will have high himma and a great level of a boost, which wants you to do dhikr, wants you to do salawat, wants you to do so much good deeds. Why? Because of the awe and the aura around a sheikh specifically who gives this away because he's getting it from Allah. He receives it from Allah and he's giving it to you. It's not physical, it's not tangible. You can't see it. It's more of a connection with the sheikh, and you have this boost of ibadah, a boost of yearning to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is what happened when people saw Imam Jazuli. They were instantly attracted. They see success, they see some miracles around him. They want to know what's so great, what has made him like above others, what makes him special. It is the ibadah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the sacrifice and you know the dedication to Allah's deen and his the deen of Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam, the kitab and the sunnah, emulation, adopting implementation. This is the reality of how people wish to become awliya. This is what you need to do. It's not, people can't sit and become awliya without holding a misbah or reading something. You know, you have to do effort. There's efforts are required. Thereafter, he went to a place called As-Safi. There's a two ways of saying As-Safi or Safi, one of these places. He went to this place to settle after his return from Hajj, Mecca, Medina, and Cairo. He went to these places, Damascus. He visited this place after his demise of the Sheikh, with it coming back to give guidance to people. His tariqah, he initiated the tariqah, the Jazuli tariqah. Although he was a Shadili Sheikh, from the lineage of Imam Shadili, he actually initiated his own tariqah, the Jazuli way. He did this obviously under the command of his Sheikh. In this way, his tariqah was very, very significant. It was very, unique. His tariqah, those people who wanted to join his tariqah, there was a practice they did. His tariqah was very symbolic. His ways, his activities, very symbolic. When people would want to initiate with the Shaykh, he would say, go shave your head, all of the hair of sin. His hair, the sha'r al-kufr, they call it. They would shave the head completely, very symbolic. It was very likened to what? To Hajj. This, likewise, he had this symbolic activities or symbolic initiations to give the murids a more tasteful, a zawq of tariqah. So this is one of the first things they would do. Once they would shave their head, they are required before bayah. This is before bayah. They are required to do seclusion for 40 days. And 40 days seclusion accompanied with fasting. 40 days secluded. Now, what's the purpose of this? To disconnect you with all of the dunya, to disconnect you with all of your, mukhalatul awam, this, mixing with people of, uselessness. Keep you away from ghibah. No ghibah and this stuff. This is one of the detrimental factors of a person's spirituality. Lying, ghibah of the tongue. Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam said, guarantee me two things, and I guarantee you paradise. The tongue, what is between your two cheeks, and what is between your two legs. Guarantee me this, control of this, and I guarantee you paradise. Reflecting upon what? The biggest dangers of a mu'min, of a believer, are led by these two things. So once we control these two things, inshallah, may Allah, may we all enter paradise with the promise of Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam. So when they were to seclude themselves for 40 days and fast for 40 days, this is the first initiation. When this is done, completed, and some people may have not completed that because they find it difficult, then they would give bayah to Imam Jazuli. Then he would accept the murid. You see how stringent conditions are from that time. Now, I'm referring to Sayyidina Shaykh. Sayyidina Shaykh in Damascus would not accept a murid unless he was a student of knowledge, who would memorize Juz Amma and the big surahs, unless they were learning Arabic language, and they know Arabic language, and dedicated time to Sayyidina Shaykh as well, weekly. This is the conditions of Shaykh Muhammad before Shaykh Abdul Rahman Shaghuri requested him to lessen the conditions to benefit the people of the West of the tariqah of the Shadili way. But it was a practice of, not very long ago, Imam Jazuli was doing very stringent conditions. Then came, obviously, Sheikh Muhammad's, obviously, in our era, we're in his era, where we're benefiting from him, but he could have made those stringent conditions, and we have never had made it to his hands. May Allah give us tawfiq to become murid sadiq of our shaykh. Then after this, they would continue to fulfill 14 conditions of tawbah. And then when they fulfill these 14 conditions, then they become murid sadiq. And amongst the conditions to avoid ghiba, lying, maintain prayers, maintain fasting, tahajjud, prayers, recitation, Quran, all these things. There's a few important ones. Thereafter, he would train his students. Imam Jazuli, ended with how many students? And it was written here, I've got it here, 12,665 students before his passing in 870. This tariqah is huge, very big. One of the initiations, one of the activities that they had to do is this following attributes. They call the 10 attributes that all muridin must know and must adapt and emulate before when they transverse their journey with him. He says these 10 qualities and praiseworthy attributes are found, should be found in a sincere disciple, which are also found in dogs. The first one, the dog, he sleeps only a little at night. وَهِيَ عَلَامَةُ الْمُحِبِّينَ. The dog who sleeps at night, it is a sign of him being a lover of his master, a lover of his owner. Then second, he complains neither of heat or cold. And this is هِيَ عَلَامَةُ الصَّابِرِينَ. A dog, if he's cold or hot, he will not bother the master. He'll endure it. He'll make sabr and he'll endure it. The third, when he dies, he leaves nothing behind which he can inherit and people can inherit from him. This is hiya alamatu zahideen. Mahiya alamatu zahideen. This is the sign of the aesthetics. When they pass away, what have they left? There's no wealth. There's no wealth they leave behind. The wealth is the wealth of ma'rifah, the wealth of love, the wealth of spirituality. This is what awliya leave behind. This is when you see, you think, what is the imam have? What does he have left? No houses, nothing. They have nothing left. When he dies, obviously, he leaves nothing behind. The next, the fourth, when he is neither angry or hateful towards anyone. This is the qualities of a dog. He doesn't hate or is angry with anyone. وَهِيَ أَلَامَةُ مُؤْمِنِينَ. This is the sign of a faithful, loyal pet. You do something, he won't be angry at you, hate you for long. When we are struck by calamity, when we are hit by problems in our lives, when our rizq becomes constricted, I say constricted, not taken away. Why? Because rizq is promised by Allah for everyone. When it's constricted for a moment from Allah, we begin to question Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why is this happening to me? Why is this happening to me? The servant should be content with whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings. We should be content with whatever Allah brings. Fifth, he is not sorrowful at the loss of a close relative, nor does he accept any assistance. وَهِيَ عَلَامَةُ مُوقِنِينَ. People who are content with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who are trusting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they're not worried about the demise of a loved one. It saddens people's hearts, but there's nothing that you say which brings ghadab Allah. لا نقول ما يغضب الله. This is the thing what we say, that when someone passes away, everything from Allah is sweet. We do not say anything which displeases Allah. Because as soon as calamity hits, even slapping your thigh at the news of calamities is a disrespect to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hitting your thigh, oh, why has this happened? No. The reaction which we have is إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ وَإِذَا أَصَابَ مُصِيبَةٌ قَالُوا إِنَّا لِلَّهِ وَإِنَّا إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ. Number six is when he is given something, he consumes it and is content. وَهِيَ أَلَامَةُ الْقَائِنِينَ. It is a sign of contentment. When a dog is given, he'll eat it. He'll be content. He won't say, oh, I want the chicken today, I want the fish today. He won't have another thing. He'll say, if it's dog food today, it's dog food, that's it. If it's water there, it's water there. These are the qualities that Imam Jazuli mentioned in his Mumtul Asma, the author has written about him, that these were meant to be adapted or emulated by the murids of Imam Jazuli. Adapt the quality of the dogs. Can you imagine, like a murid coming, he wants to give a shaykh, there's a shaykh there and he goes, you have to be like a dog. He'd be like, oh, forget this. This guy's off his... I don't want to sit with this guy. You know, you see, people would be very like... Now, when we have Alamat al-Kilab, there's a very interesting book, Mufti Wajid may have known, Tafdeel al-Kilab, ala kathirin mimman labith al-thiyab. Imam Mirzaban, I believe. Mirzaban. He died in 309. A book written by the scholar, The Virtues of Dogs Over Those People Who Wear Clothes on Their Back. He wrote a book about the virtues of dog. Why? Because a dog will never go against his owner, or a dog will never be not content with what he's given by his owner. You can beat the dog, he'll never go against his owner. This is what one of the mentions here. And number seven, he has no known place of refuge. Dog wanders. وَعَلَامْتُ السَّائِحِينَ A person, the sign of a wanderer, a person who just wanders on the earth, finds Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wherever he goes. He goes, I have to return home I need to return home. He has no home. He wanders and he finds a place on the side, he sleeps there. This is the level of our spirituality should be, to be wanderers on the earth, to find Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He sleeps in any place that he finds. And that is a sign, وَهِيَ أَلَامْتُ الرَّادِيِينَ The people who are content with Allah, rida, pleasure. Number nine, once he knows his master, he never hates him, even if the master beats him or starves him. وَهِيَ أَلَامْتُ الْعَارِفِينَ It's a sign of the arifs, the Gnostics. That even if the master, if the risk goes smaller, calamities hit him from left, right and center, they will still say, La ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah, la ilaha illallah. They will never stop praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the last one is, he is always hungry. This is the sign of salihin. He is always hungry, always wanting more. So these are the attributes that I find in dogs that Imam Jazuli mentioned regarding his tariqah, the way his tariqah was. His main students were the following. Imam Abdul Aziz al-Tabba', Imam Tabba', he's one of the seven saints of Morocco. In Marrakesh, he's buried in one of the vicinities. The next, Imam Abdullah al-Ghazwani. And then the local name for it is Maul Qusur. And the other successor, and one of the main successors, is Imam Muhammad al-Sughayr al-Sahli. This is one of his main students. And it is this student, by him, by the virtue of this student, we have received the Dalail Khayrat in our hands. The nuskha, there's a few nuskhas by each student, which we'll talk about inshallah close to this, his works. After a few years of calling people to Allah, building his reputation, people heard about him. People heard about the Shaykh and they went to him. They flooded the Sahara, they flooded the area and they went to see him, take from him. Initiate in his tariqah, take barakah from him. Later, there's two narratives. One narrative is the governor of the era, Safi. What did he do? He got jealous of the attraction. He got jealous of the numbers of students that Imam Jazuli brought. They get intimidated, insecure, because they think that all a scholar has to say is go against the ruler, and khalas, the ruler will be overturned. So what he did is he made life difficult for Imam Jazuli, and he gave him an ultimatum, and he said, leave before I make you leave from this world. And then Imam Jazuli mentioned, he said, I will leave, but I'll promise you, you'll follow me. And later is exactly what happened, is when the Portuguese came and they drove out all of the areas, the governor of Safi, he was pushed away and he followed Imam Jazuli to his area of Aqar. The other narrative is that people just got jealous of him, people made rumors about him, and then he was forced to leave by the local people. They made accusations against him. This is very normal. When a sheikh is in an area, people, other shuyukh, become jealous. You know, other shuyukh become jealous, and when there's a big influx of people going towards him, not to them, then they have to do something. And this is obviously from the insincerity of the sheikhs who do this stuff. So he moved to Afghar, back to close to where his birthplace was, in Sousse, South Morocco. There he began to remain and call up people to Allah. He began writing the Dalail Khayrat in Fez, and he concluded it in other places. He wrote it and he revised it later. And the complete revision, when it finished, was I believe in 862. In 862 or 864, he completed the revision and gave it to Imam Sahli. His death. Now, his death is something which is very eventful. There's two narratives as well. The first one is he remained 6 years. Thereafter, he was poisoned in his homeland, in his hometown, by the governor of Safi, by a local governor. He poisoned him, and he passed away on the 16th of Rabiul Awal in Salat al-Fajr. In the either they say the first raka'ah in the sajda, the first raka'ah, or the sajda, second sajda of the second raka'ah. He passed away in this manner. Imam Muhammad Sahli mentioned, Imam Jazuli acquired two maqams, maqam al-Siddiqiyya and maqam al-Shahada. The maqam of truthfulness for how his life, benefiting people, and the second, maqam al-Shahada, martyrdom in the way of Allah. It only befits his ending to be martyred. Why? Because he led a life of obedience to Allah, led a life of spirituality. And one of the best ending is the ending of martyrdom. Nothing tops that. Those who are killed, يُقْتَلُ فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ أَمْوَاتْ بَلْهُمْ أَحْيَا. Do not say those who are slain or killed in the way of Allah as dead, rather they are alive. This is the bushra of awliya, that they have no fear in this world. لَهُمُ الْبُشْرَى فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ. They have the glad tidings in this world and the glad tidings in the Akhirah. Imam Jazuli is mentioned even up to now. What distinguished him? What distinguished his faith and his connection with the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? If you were to take anything from the life of Imam Jazuli, is that the results of your ibadah, of your worship, is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If Allah wants you to benefit people, He'll make you known to people. Once you're known to people and you benefit them, and Allah wishes to continuously allow people to benefit from you, He'll make your dhikr am. You make your remembrance continuous until the day of Qiyamah. So there's two narratives that followed this. The first narrative is that they buried him straight after Salat al-Zuhr on that same day in the masjid that he studied, the masjid that he built, the zawiya he built. They buried him there in Afghar, in Sousse, southern Morocco. Or the other one is the following, that there was a dispute between two people, the local political leaders and the Muridin. The Muridin said, we want to bury the Shaykh straight away. The political people of his era wanted to use Imam Jazuli as a tawassul through their battles against the Portuguese. So what they did is they built an ark and something to carry his blessed body, and they would take his body to every battle and they would fight with the tawassul of his body. And apparently, Imam Suhali says, or Imam the author of Mumtul Asma, Imam Muhammad Mahdi al-Farsi says, there was not a battle except that they won it with the body of Imam Jazuli. They won every battle. And when did it all turn over? And when was he buried? As soon as the governor was killed by his wife for a dispute that they did, and the governor got killed by his wife. And then they buried him after that. Once he was buried, and this is a very famous story, I know everyone knows this. Once he is buried, what happened was they transferred his body, after 77 years, they transferred his body to Marrakesh. Why? One of the narratives is that the leader did not want an uprising to happen. And what the leader did is he moved his body away from the area so that a community won't come and take his body and do the same thing that the governor did in his time. To take his body as a form of a tawassul and tabarruk to win the battles. Because he knew the maqam of Imam Jazuli. The dua of Imam Jazuli, the barakah of Imam Jazuli was unlimited. It was powerful. So he moved him away from the area to save his hukuma. So they moved to Marrakesh. The beautiful miracle of this is that after 77 years, Imam Jazuli was exhumed or removed from his grave, and they obviously looked toward his blessed face. Every hair on his face was fresh from his head and his beard. To the extent, in the bio, they said that the Muridin, or the students, the disciples, wanted to see how fresh he was. They placed their finger upon his face and his body, and the blood would move and return. It would move away from the place of pressure and return. And that was a sign of haya as like we have, we push up our hands and the blood would move away and return. Likewise, Imam Jazuli had that after 77 years. What do we take from this? We take that the fact that salawat preserved him. Salawat preserved him. His connection to Rasulullah preserved him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His dedication to deen preserved him. Thereafter, he was moved to Marrakesh and he was buried in a zawiya which is built from him, and later a mausoleum, a maqam, a masjid, a zawiya is built around him later years. There's a secret about this, about his grave. I'm not sure if everyone knows about this or whether it's a myth or not, but I heard it from the muqaddam in the maqam when I went in September 2014. I went to visit Imam Jazuli on the way. I was leaving for the airport and I stopped. It's very nice to know that, you know, sometimes Moroccans don't know the maqams often. You have to say a different name or a different area. The name that's common in Morocco is Sidi Bin Salman. They don't say Imam Jazuli. As we're aware of his name, Jazuli, Imam Jazuli. His name is, according to Moroccans, is Sidi Bin Salman. Sidi Bin Salman is an area as well where he's buried. I went to visit him and I sat with the Muqaddam, and also he is actually from the lineage of Imam Jazuli. He mentioned the following. He said that Imam Jazuli is actually not buried under this big red maqam that is built upon of his grave. You see the big one, the four golden posts, right? He mentioned that the Imam is not actually buried here. If you want to give salam, go behind the wall and that's where he's buried. And this is written by Imam Muhammad Mahdi al-Fas. He mentions in his Mumtah al-Asma that his body is buried behind that wall that you see. Why? Because to keep people from stealing his body. Because they knew that his maqam was great. So what it was is a form of protection for his body, to keep away from those who thieves. So this is something I learned new when I was there and confirmed by this author. This was his death in 870. 16th Rabi'ul Awwal, 870. So he was born in 807, Hawali, and he died 870. That made him 63 years of age. A age of Rasul, the prophetic passing, you'd call it, the prophetic passing. So this is his life. What did he leave behind? What did Imam Jazuli leave behind? One of the most celebrated works, inshallah, I'll come to, is the Dalail Khayrat, Guide of All Goodness, Shawariq al-Anwar, fi Zikr al-Salat al-Habib Muhtar, Nabi al-Muhtar. One of the most beautiful books I'll mention, inshallah, I'll speak about in detail. Other books is the following. And I told you, Imam Jazuli was a scholar. He wasn't just an am person. He was a mutamassik scholar, mutabahir. He wrote a book called Aqidat al-Imam Jazuli. Why? Because he wanted to preserve the Aqidah of Ahl Sunnah amongst his Murideen and the people of his community. Risalat al-Tawheed, another book by him. Risalatu ajwib al-Deen wa-Dunya. A Risala of Answers of the Deen and Dunya. Kitab al-Zuhd. Another one, Kitab al-Nush al-Tam liman qala Rabbi Allah wa summa istaqam. A complete guidance or complete advice for he who says Allah is my Lord, summa istaqam, and thereafter he remains steadfast. A book about tasawwuf, mainly tasawwuf. Another hizb, he had a lot of litanies. Amongst them was Hizb al-Subhan al-Da'im al-Qa'im, La Yazul, or La Yazal. Hizb al-Falah, another litany, and Hizb al-Hamd. These are many litanies that we hardly hear of this Imam. Before I go to Dalal Khayrat, a very beautiful story, I want to read some of his litany. The litany is called Hizb al-Tawheed, al-Musamma Subhanu al-Da'im la yazul. He wrote this for his family only. He gave ijazah to his family only. And it's one of the most beautiful poems or litanies I've ever read. It encompasses a lot of aqidah. سبحان الدائم لا يزول سبحان الباقي لا يفنى سبحان الله المولانا إلهنا جل وعلا إلهنا نعم المولى إلهنا نعم المسير نسير إلهنا نعم القدير واحد القهار. He goes through جل الواحد القهار أن شبح والنزير جل الموصوف بالكمال أن الشبح والمثال Jalla al-Aziz wal-Muhit and al-Idraq al-Bil-Uqul. Is referring to the attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فَجَلَّ الْمَوْجُودَ الْقَدِيمِ أَنَ الدِّدْ وَالنِّدِ كَانَ اللَّهُ وَحْدُهُ وَلَا شَيْءَ مَأَهُ فَأَوْجَدَ الْمَوْجُودَاتِ لِيُعْرَفَ الْجَلَّهُ لِيُعْرَفَ جَلَّ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى وَأَوْجَدَ الْمَوْجُودَاتِ لِيَعْبُدُ اللَّهُ جَلَّهُ. This is the hizb of Imam Jazuli. Allah created the earth, created the qawm so that Allah is known. نِعْمَ الْمَوْلَى الْوَاجِبِ والمخلوق الجائز واجب الوجود and جائز الوجود, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is واجب الوجود. His existence is necessary. The comparison to our existence is جائز, possible to exist and not possible to exist. We come in and out of existence. So he mentions نعم المولى واجب والمخلوق الجائز نعم المولى قديم والمخلوق الحادث نعم المولى دائم والمخلوق الحالك نعم المولى الغني والمخلوق الفقير نعم المولى العزيز والمخلوق الزليل نعم المولى العظيم والمخلوق الحكير. It refers to Aqidah so much. He was a great scholar in Aqidah and in Fiqh, in many things, as we have a lot of saying for him to go through. So Dalail al-Khayrat was first initiated in Fez, written in Fez, but revised throughout his life and finished towards about 8 years before his demise in 862. According to Imam Nabahani, in his commentary of Imam of Dalal Khairat, Dalalat al-Wadihat ala Dalal Khairat, Imam Yusuf Nabahani, Mujaddid of the previous century, two centuries, he wrote a commentary on this Dalal Khairat, this book. Other scholars, Imam Sharnubi, Imam Ahmad Zarruq, did two sharhs on that book. A few contemporary scholars and obviously scholars in this era as well. And one of the most, the biggest one, is written by Imam Mahdi al-Fasi. This scholar, the one who wrote a biography of Imam Jazuli, he wrote the biggest one. It's called Muta'al al-Musarrat bi Jala'il Dalal al-Khairat. The story, very famous story, very famous, everyone knows this. And I want to mention, due to the barakah and our insignificant dedication to this Imam, we will not be able to complete a lecture which would be worthy of his remembrance, because he was so amazing. Dalal al-Khayrat. This book was written due to an inspiration of an event. The event follows as Imam Jazuli was wandering towards in an area in Fez, and he was looking for water because prayer was due, and he was requesting water to make wudu. He came to a well where he did not find a bucket to remove the water from the well. Another narrative, the rope that had the bucket, could not find that either. It's two narratives. He was looking for water and he could not find it. And he came towards the well and then he stopped. Thereafter, he saw a young girl. And it says in the biography, maqamin alin, a very high place she was sat upon. She was sat in a high place. Either she was sat on a roof, or Imam Jazuli was acknowledging her maqam. And maybe a metaphorical understanding. When he saw her, فَهِيَ جَالِسَةٌ عَلَى مَقَامٍ مَآلٍ. She was standing on a raised platform. Whether it's metaphorical or literal, if you take the literal for now. So she was looking towards the Imam and she inquired, who are you? And he replied, I'm Muhammad ibn Sulaiman al-Jazuli. And then she sat back and she said, you're the Imam. You're the Imam that everyone is talking about. They praise you from east and west, and you're here looking for what? You're looking for water to do wudu. SubhanAllah, you're such a big Imam. People praise you so much and you can't bring water from a well. And then he requested some assistance, and she spat into the water, into the well, and the water gushed, overflowing from to the top. And then Imam Jazuli made wudu, prayed his salah, and he went back to her and he inquired, "What bima nilti hadha al-martaba?" This is what he said. With what maqam? What have you done to achieve such a maqam like this, that you were to place your saliva into this well and the water gushes up? It's a miracle. Obviously, miracles are very common in Imam Jazuli's life in that era. Awliya, left and right. So when you want to inquire, what made you acquire such a maqam with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And you replied, بِقَصْرَةِ صَلَاتِ عَلَى النَّبِي عَلَيْهِ صَلَاتُ وَسْلَمُ, with abundant salutations upon the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And he made an oath that from there on, I will write a book on salawat. What I want to allude to this story, everyone has heard this story. What I want the people to take back from the story is the fact that a young girl, a female, inspired one of the greatest imams and inspired him to write one of the greatest books in our times. A young girl sitting upon a roof, and she had a little conversation with the imam, and what inspired the imam? A young girl. So it shows us the role of women in Islam. The deen is, one third of the deen, I believe, is built from the opinions of Imam Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anha. The role of women in Islam. Sayyidah Aisha was one of those people, a great faqiha muhaddatha of the era of Medina. So my point was that we have to understand the maqam of women. We have to give opportunities to women. If you have a society where women are suppressed and, you know, kept away from the masajid, because the problem with this is ignorance prevails. When ignorance prevails, our children are ignorant. Why? Because they sit in the laps of the mother more than the laps of the father. So we have to give an opportunity to our sisters to benefit from scholarly discourses, so that they can become these great women of Allah and benefit and inspire, you know, the Jazuli of our time, you know, to create an Imam Jazuli of their own. So this is the story of Imam Jazuli. He made this book, Dalail Khayrat, 8 chapters of salawats upon the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Now the copies. Now how was this formed? There was a few students, Imam Sahli, Imam Ghazwani, who's buried in Marrakesh as well, and Imam Isa, these few scholars, who had the benefit and the opportunity to sit with Imam Jazuli. Imam Jazuli gave him variations. He gave a nuskha to each. And depending on their meeting, how close was the meeting of each student before the demise of the Shaykh, they may have variations in their nuskha. And one of the most mu'tabar nuskhas is Imam Sahli's nuskha. Imam Sheikh Nuh Hamikala's edition have in the beginning, هذه نسخة سحلية in the edition. So this is the most famous one, Imam Sahli's edition, Imam Muhammad al-Sahli. This Dalail al-Khayrat, many of us read it, right? And I myself have very limited Arabic. Whatever I can understand from it, I do take. I think Mufti Wajid would be very comprehensive of this understanding of this book. And may Allah give him tawfiq and love of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and allow us to benefit from him. When you read the salawat, you're just stuck. You're awestruck due to the amount of possibilities and the multiplicity of the salawats that Imam Jazuli mentions. For example, Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali Sayyidina Muhammad adada man salla alayhi. Oh Allah, send peace and blessings upon the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon his holy household and his companions, to the amount of those who send salutations upon him in the earth. Can you imagine how many people on the earth, face of the earth, at one moment in time, send salutation upon the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? It just multiplies and multiplies and multiplies. Oh Allah, send salutation upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, adada man lam yusalli alayhi, to the amount of those who do not send salutation upon the Prophet alayhi wa sallam. Those who are sending salutations and those who are not. Oh Allah, give salutation to the Prophet to that amount. How was this formed? What was the I'd say tartib of the salawats in this book? Imam Muhammad al-Fasi mentions in his Dalail al-Khayrat Sharh, in his commentary, he says he starts with the salawats of the Prophet. And he began with the khayrul salawat is Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali Sayyidina Muhammad kama sallayta ala Sayyidina Ibrahim wa ala ali Sayyidina Ibrahim innaka hamidun majid. This salawat is taught directly from the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam to the Sahaba. Because he mentioned, send salutations upon me, they will reach me. How will they reach you when you've passed away, Ya Rasulullah? Allah will allow you to allow them to reach me, don't worry. And they taught, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught the Sahaba what salawat. And it was Allahumma salli ala, the one we read through the Ibrahimiyya in our prayers. So this, the Imam Jazuli he initiated his book with the salawats of the prophets, then the salawats of the Sahaba, then the salawats of the Tabi'een, right? And the Tabi'een, the salawat of Imam Shafi'i, kullama dhakarahu al-dhakirun wa ghafla an dhikrihi al-ghafilun. This is the salawat of Imam Shafi'i. Oh Allah, send peace and blessings upon the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to the amount of everyone who mentions you and to the amount of everyone who forgets you. The multiplicity. Oh Allah, send salutation upon the Prophet of Allah bi'adl al-qatr min qatl al-amtar, for every rain drop that drops on the earth. Munzu khalaqt ad-dunya ila yawm al-qiyamah. From the day you created creation, every raindrop that has fallen gives salutation to the Prophet of Allah until the day of Qiyamah. Can you imagine the multitude of salawats upon the Prophet of Allah at one moment in time? So when you read this, you should try to read it accompanied with the translation. It gives you a very a beautiful feeling to know that how much salawats is being dedicated to the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's an amazing feeling. So when you read this, inshallah, read it with understanding. And you see there's a lot of aqeedah points in here. He refers to Allah in the sifas, wajib al-wujud. It shows, it reflects. When you see a scholar, if you want to know, if you haven't never met him, if you want to see what level of scholarship he has, read his books. Once you read his books and you see what he's written, then you can reflect and understand what level the scholar was on. When you read the scholars' books, this is how you'd know what level he is on. Inshallah, I want to relay words that he has mentioned. And I don't think a lot of people hear his words. They're beautiful words. Amongst his kalam is the following. Whoever has three things in their heart while seeking tawbah from Allah, then it is rejected. Those who have arrogance with knowledge, those who have bad character, and those who have offense, su'al dhan, with people. These three qualities in people's hearts will veil you from sincere tawbah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is one of the beautiful ones. Imam Jazuli, yaqulu Imam Jazuli, li kulli dhikrin fikr, wa li kulli fikr nur, wa li kulli nur sir, wa li kulli sir ibadah, wa li kulli ibadah hudur, wa li kulli hudur shuhudun, wa li kulli shuhudin haybatun, wa li kulli hayba ta'zim, wa li kulli ta'zim tanzih, wa li kulli tanzih tahmid, wa li kulli tahmid taqrib, wa li kulli taqrib hadith, wa li kulli hadith fahm, wa li kulli al-fahm lazza, wa li kulli lazza shawq, wa man lam yasluk hazihi al-maqamati fa'alayhi bi mujalisat ahliha. لِكُلِّ ذِكْر, for every remembrance of Allah, there's a fikr, a thought. For every thought, there's a light. For every light, there's a secret. For every secret, there's ibadah. For every ibadah, there's presence. For every presence, there's witnessing. For every witnessing, there's reverence. For every reverence, there's respect. For every respect, there's tanzih, transcendence. For every transcendence is tahmid, praise. For every praise is taqareeb, proximity. For every proximity, there's hadith, speech. For every speech, there's fahm, understanding. For every fahm, there's ladha, pleasure. For every pleasure, there's shawq, there's yearning. He who does not transverse these maqamats in this way, then he should take it upon himself to sit with those who are transverted. This is one of his words. عَلَيْكَ بِذِكْرِ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ فَإِذَا قُلْتَ لَا إِلَهَ كُنْتَ فَانِيًا عَنْ جَمِيعِ الْوُجُودِ. Upon you is to take the dhikr of La ilaha illallah, La ilaha illallah. Why? When you say La ilaha illallah, when you come to La ilaha, there's no God, then you become fani, annihilated from every wujud around you. This is the reality of La ilaha illallah. There's nothing real except Allah. this earth, this everything around us is perishing. It'll perish. If Allah wished it, it'll perish in the next moment. The only thing, وَيَبْقَى Allah. The only thing remains is Allah. لا إله إلا الله. There's nothing real except Allah. لا إله إلا الله. There's nothing around us but Allah. This is the reality of the dhikr of Allah. And he mentions this. Another beautiful saying is مُخَالَتَةُ الْعَوَامِ تُذْهِبُ الْبِنُورِ الْقَلْبِ وَحَيْبَةُ الْوَجْهِ. Mixing with bad people, general bad people, removes the light of the heart and the reverence or the awe about the face. وَمَنْ مَاتَ عَلَى ذَلِكَ جَاءَ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ وَوَجْهُ كَالْقَمْرِ الْمَخْصُوفِ. He who continues like this and dies in this state, he will come on يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ with a face like an eclipsed moon. It has light behind it, but is veiled with the veiling of mixing with bad people. وَلَا نُورَ لَهُ فَلِيَجْتَهِدْ أَقِلْ فِي مُخَالَةِ الْخَوَاسِ. For a person who has aql, he should mix with the people of spirituality. وَفِي مُخَالَةِ الْخَوَاسِ ثَلَاثُ خِصَالِ. In the company, in literally the mixing, in the company of the elite, the Sufis, there's three things that you will acquire. اكتصاب العلم, acquiring knowledge, صفاء القلب, pure heart, والسلامة الصدر, and security of your chest. This is the benefits of sitting with those people of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another one he mentioned, inshallah, I'll conclude in these. أول العلم النافع العلم بالله. The most, and he mentioned the knowledges that we all have to undertake. أول العلم النافع, the first knowledge, the beneficial knowledge that everyone must take, العلم بالله, knowledge of Allah. What? Knowledge of Aqeedah, the sifats of Allah, the attributes of Allah, those things that are possible for him, impossible for him, those things regarding Allah. This is the first, this is, I say, instructions from Imam Jazuli for anyone of any level of studying. So the first one, journeying the way to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-ilmu billah bi sifatihi, thumma al-ilmu bi ahkamillah wa bi amrihi. The next is knowledge of the ahkam, the rulings of Allah and His orders. Thumma al-ilmu bi afat al-arwah. Then knowledge of the detrimental factors of the soul and the heart. Thumma al-ilmu bi afat al-asrar. And then the dangers of secrets. Basically, spiritually, when people transverse, if they are unguided, then they will receive something which they're not ready for. ثُمَّ عِلْمُ بِآفَاتِ الْحَضْرَةِ. Then the knowledge of the afat, or the detrimental effects of hadra. So in presence, how should you sit in the presence of a sheikh? How should you sit in the presence of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام? How should you sit in the presence of Allah ultimately? ثُمَّ عِلْمُ بِآدَابِ الْمُجَالَسَةِ. ثُمَّ عِلْمُ بِالْآدَابِ الْمُرَاقَبَةِ. ثُمَّ الْعِلْمُ بِآدَابِ الْمُشَاهَدَةِ. Then the adab of sitting, the adab of muraqaba, the adab of mushahada, witnessing, the adab of muhadatha, speaking, the adab of speaking eloquently. Then summa ilm al adab al istima, the adab of listening. Summa ilmu bi adab al ilham, then the knowledge or the adab of ilham, inspiration. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billahi al aliyyil azim. This is what he mentions. And inshallah, this is my last one, I promise. وَعَلَى الْمُرِيدِ أَنْ يَكُولْ كَلَامُهُ حِكْمَةً. He says this upon the murid, right? Upon the murid is that his kalam should be hikmah, wisdom. وَصَمْتُهُ تَفَكُّرٌ. And his silence should be reflection or thoughtful thinking. وَنَزْرُهُ اِعْتَبَارٌ. And his sight or looking towards something should be consideration. وَفَرْحُهُ بِاللَّهِ وَبِأَنْبِيَاهِ وَأَوْلِيَاهِ. His happiness should lie with Allah, the awliya and the anbiya. And وَالْحُزْنُ. And his sadness should reflect upon whatever stems from himself of badness. And this is instruction from himself to murids. We can take this upon ourselves to emulate his instructions and benefit from his knowledge. He was an imam of great caliber. He's not imam just of Dalail Khayrat. He was a great scholar who benefited many of his many of his murid and his community. There's a saying that in the zikr salihin tanzil al-rahma, that at the mentioning of the salihin, of the great men of Allah, Allah descends rahmah upon the people. This is why we sit here learning about these men of Allah. I commend Essential Islam in initiating this project of allowing people to benefit and know about these men of Allah that have passed away. You know, it makes you think, each and every one of us, we come from different backgrounds. I'm from Reading, Navid's from Bradford, everyone's from Bradford, Dewsbury, Stoke and Trent, different places. Our roots are where? Pakistan, right? Or India, or Bangladesh. When we think about it, if we were to remain in our places, how Allah has allowed the remembrance and the knowledge of these men of Allah in our lives is astonishing. We've come, our parents have come from where? From the Kotis of Mirpur, or of Kashmir, or Pindi, wherever, of India, wherever you want to be, right? They came from all the way there, they settled in UK, and we are fortunate enough to know about these great imams, these great scholars of Islam, despite them being buried or alive 800, 600 years ago, prior to us, in a place in Maghrib, in Morocco, far away from us. It's astonishing that Allah allows us to know these people. It's a rahmah of Allah. If Allah allows you to know the names of Imam Jazuli, I pray Allah, I guarantee you Allah is having inayah, there's great blessings in your life. There's great openings in your life by knowing the Imam of our time. And if this initiative that Essential Islam is doing is because Allah wants you to know this great Imam so that you come closer to him. Their remembrance, their legacy is being remembered. Why? Because of their connection with Allah and the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. If we want to be remembered in any form and we wish to be remembered with good, the good we have left, then dedicate yourself to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are building our legacies right here, right now. At this present moment, what you do will reflect how you're remembered after. And we want to be remembered in a way which pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet. Because their remembrance is abqa. Abad. Allah's remembrance, the Prophet will be abqa. It will be the most highest remembrance. So if we want to be amongst those who are remembered with good, we cling to Allah and the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. May Allah give us tawfiq to adapt and adopt the teachings of Imam Jazuli, his love which was inherited by his sheikhs, and what allowed him to write this best book, Dalail Khayrat. I pray Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us the true love which he was inspired to write this book into our hearts. Give us tawfiq to read salawat upon the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. With every salawat, I pray Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings us closer to him, Allah, and his beloved Prophet Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. I pray Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless the life, bless the qabr and the men of Allah, khas the Imam Jazuli, and give him a high rank in paradise. And give us tawfiq to visit him in his maqam. Give us tawfiq to benefit from his ma'rifah, from his ishq and mahabbah. Give us tawfiq to continuously use his book and benefit from his works. I pray Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses the brothers in attendance of this majlis and the brothers who organize and who did ta'awun in this gathering. Oh Allah, bless them immensely and give them rizq wasi' for the benefit of people. Oh Allah, we ask you to bless our scholar, our teacher, Shaykh Mufti Wajid, and may Allah give him a high rank in paradise and give him a barakah and preserve him for the ummah. Oh Allah, we ask you to bless everyone in this attendance by the barakah of salat upon the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Bi sirri surat al-Fatiha. Dedicate one last Fatiha to Imam Abi Abdullah Muhammad ibn Sulaiman al-Juzuli. Whenever we start his book or end his book, we start with the Fatiha of his soul, inshallah. Al-Fatiha.